Love you, O Lord, I will love you, O Lord, my God, all my soul, with all my mind and strength. And I will love you, O Lord, I will love you, O Lord, I will love you, O Lord, my my strength, my song. And I will love you, O Lord, my strength. I love you, O Lord, my strength, my song, my salvation. And I love you, O love you, O Lord, my strength, my strength. Oh, I love you, love you, love you, oh Lord, my. I love you, love you, Lord, my strength. Oh, I love you, love you, love you, oh Lord, my strength. Strengthen my salvation. Strengthen my salvation. Oh, I love you, love you. Love you, oh Lord, my strength. Oh, I love you, love you, love you, oh Lord, my God. Oh, I love you, love you, love you, oh Lord, my strength. I love you, Lord, my salvation. Praise shall continually, continually be in my mouth. Oh, oh, your praise shall continually, continually, continually be in my mouth. Oh, and I will sing, sing, sing your praise. Lord, I'll sing, sing, sing your praise. Oh, I'll sing, 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 sing your praise. And I love you, love you, love you, oh Lord, my. Oh, I love you, love you, love you, my salvation. Oh, I love you, love you, love you, oh Lord, my strength. Oh, I love you, Lord, my God. When as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. serve the Lord as we will serve you. Me and my heart, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. With fasting, in watching, in the labors and the heat of the day, in glory, in honor.
Glory, in honor.
In labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ,
in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ, in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory.
Oh, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. Oh, in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and the approaches of Christ, in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ, in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ, in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ, in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ,
in fasting, in watching, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ, in fasting, in washing, in labors, in the heat of the day, in glory, in honor, in the sufferings and reproaches of Christ.
We will serve you, Lord. We will serve only you. We will serve you, Lord. We will serve only you. Oh, and as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you. As for me and my house, we serve the Lord. Serve the Lord as we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, We will serve you, Lord. Serve you, Lord. Yes, we will serve you, Lord. We will serve you, Lord. We will serve you, Lord. Yes, we will serve you, Lord. Oh, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Serve the Lord, yes, we will serve you, Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord. Serve you, Lord, yes, we will serve you, Lord. We serve you, Lord. Oh, Lord, our strength. Oh, Lord, our song, our salvation. Jesus. Desired of all nations, Jesus, desire of my soul, light of my salvation. Jesus. So deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. Oh, so deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love. Oh, so deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love. Oh, a pearl. For so deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great this love of God. Oh, so deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, So why this love? So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love. Oh, sing it, saints. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love. Oh, and I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love. Oh, I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love. Oh, rejoicing in your love, rejoicing in your grace, rejoicing in your mercy, God, rejoicing in all you've done. And I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going. Of your presence, your beautiful presence, of your glorious presence. I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going. Of your presence, your beautiful presence. No, I'm not going, I'm not going. All I need, Lord, in your presence, fullness of joy. In your presence is life and peace. In your presence, fullness of joy. In your presence is all I need, Lord. I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm not going. For in your presence is fullness of joy. In your presence, life and peace. In your presence, fullness of joy. In your presence is all I need. Oh, in your presence is fullness of joy. In your presence is life and peace. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your presence is all I need. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Oh, and these dreams have made glad your city, God. Oh, the healing water. Oh, your healing water's flowing out. Your healing water. Your healing water's flowing out. Streams have made glad your city, Lord. Oh, the streams that make glad your city. Oh, in righteousness, peace, and joy. In righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Dwelling here in the kingdom of God. In righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Oh, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Oh, we love flowing in the Holy Ghost. We love flowing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, freedom, oh, flowing in the Holy Ghost. Healing, oh, flowing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, we love flowing in the Holy Ghost. We flowing in the Holy Ghost. In righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Oh, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Filled with the fullness of God, complete in Christ Jesus. Filled with righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Oh, and we love flowing in the Holy Ghost. We love flowing in the Holy Ghost. We love flowing in the Holy Ghost. This freedom flowing in the Holy Ghost. Freedom flowing in the Holy Ghost. I shift my left today. What till I'm on that cause she dead on my age. I'm giving thanks most excellently to you, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, we honor and adore your name, oh God. Be glorified in your church. Be magnified in us, your people. Alleluia. Oh, we love flowing in the Holy Ghost. We love flowing in the Holy Ghost. Freedom flowing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, freedom flowing in the Holy. Such power flowing in the Holy Ghost. Such power flowing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, Holy Spirit, have your way tonight among your people, among your saints. Oh, we love flowing in the Holy Ghost. flowing in the Holy Ghost. Such freedom flowing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, we Holy Ghost, such freedom flowing in the Holy Ghost, such freedom flowing in the Holy Ghost. There's power flowing in the Holy Ghost, power flowing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, we love. We're flowing in the Holy Ghost. We love flowing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, in this righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Oh, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Filled up with God, the dwelling place of the Almighty, the temple of the Lord, the temples of the Holy Ghost. Oh, and we love flowing in the Holy Ghost. We love flowing in the Holy Ghost. Such flowing in the Holy Ghost, such freedom flowing in the Holy such righteousness, peace, and joy. Righteousness, peace, and joy. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Righteousness, peace, and joy. Righteousness, peace, and joy. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love. Oh, I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love. Yes, I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love. Oh, I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect. I'll give a shout of praise. The shouts ring out of joy. The shouts of thanksgiving and honor and I'm living for everything. I adore you, Jesus. Lord, you're everything. I'm living for everything. I adore you, Jesus. Oh, Lord, you're everything. I'm living for everything. I adore you, Lord Jesus. Lord, you're everything I'm living for. Everything I adore you. We adore you, Father. We honor you, O Lord. We honor you, O Lord. We honor you, O Lord. And take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, and let them flow in ceaseless prayer. Oh, let them flow in ceaseless prayer. Take my will and take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. Oh, it shall be thy royal. Oh, forever. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. And take my moments and my days, and let them flow in ceaseless praise. Oh, let them flow, and they will flow in ceaseless praise. Oh, for you are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. You are the mighty God. Oh, you're the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and forever. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We give you praise. Hallelujah, we give you thanks, Lord. Oh, you are the mighty God. Oh, you're the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, you are the mighty God, the great I am. There is no one like you. There is no one like you, Almighty God. No one like you. No one like you. For you are the mighty God. The great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God. The great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The one who the mountains shake, the seas roar at your presence, at your awesome presence, mighty God. Mighty God. Oh, you are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. And you are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. Yes, you are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was oh, you'll find me in the place of the rejoicing. You'll find me in the place of giving thanks. Oh, for I will wait on the Lord. I put my trust in God. My trust is in you, God. Oh, you'll find me in the place of the mighty. You'll find me in the place of giving thanks. Oh, I will be found in the place of the rejoicing. blessing. Oh, in the place of those who have strength. Oh, those who know their God shall do great exploits. Oh, those who know their God shall do great things by His anointing. When you'll find me in the place of the rejoicing, you find me in the place of giving thanks. Oh, you find me in the place of the mighty. You find me in the place of those who have strength. Oh, you will find me in the place of the mighty. Oh, you will find me in the place of those who have strength. Oh, for I will wait on the Lord. I put my trust in God. Oh, I trust in God. Oh, I will wait on the Lord. I put my trust in God. I trust in God. When you find me in the place of the rejoicing, you'll find me in the place of giving thanks. You will find me in the place of the mighty. You'll find me in the place of those who have strength. Oh, you'll find me in the place of the rejoicing. You'll find me in the place of giving thanks. Oh, you'll find me in the place of the mighty. Oh, you'll find me in the place of those who have strength. Oh, for I will wait on the Lord. I put my trust in God. I trust in God. When I will wait on the Lord, I put my trust in God, trust in God. Yes, you will find me in the place of the rejoicing. Oh, you'll find me in the place of giving thanks. Oh, and most excellently, you will find me in the place of the mighty. Oh, you will find me in the place of those who have strength.
Hallelujah! Woo! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Woo, woo, woo.
Strength. The Lord is my salvation. Endued with power by the Spirit of the Lord. I've been endued with power by the Holy Ghost. The promise. The promise of the Father. The promise of the Almighty. The Spirit of God. Endued with the Spirit of God to live the life of God. Oh, praise, praise, praise Him. Oh, praise, praise, praise Him now. Deeper, deeper. Oh, praise, praise, praise Him now. Oh, we praise, praise, praise You now, Father. Oh, we praise, praise, praise You now, oh God. Oh, we praise, praise, praise You now, God. Oh, we praise, praise, praise You now, God. Oh, we praise, praise, praise You now, Almighty God. with sounds of joy and sounds of praise, with songs of adoration to the Ancient of Days. Desolation into a fruitful garden, a paradise of God, full of all the riches in Christ Jesus. Oh, praise, 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 praise Him. Oh, we praise, praise, praise You now. Oh, we praise and magnify You, Lord Most High, exalted far above everything. No higher authority or dominion than Yours, Lord Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Hallelujah. What a wonderful God we serve. What an amazing God we serve. Thank You, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. 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 Thank You, Jesus. We're citizens of heaven. Thank You, Jesus. We're eternal beings, temporarily on this earth. But we're eternal beings, gonna live forever in heaven. Yeah. Hallelujah. Our citizenship, our hope, what we live for is the next life. We will be with Father for eternity. This life is a proving grounds, a testing grounds. Who's gonna walk with God? Who's gonna follow God? The only thing that matters in this life is what we do for the kingdom, what we do in the kingdom. So, such a blessing to be here tonight among God's people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. I just want to say a quick message before introducing the most beautiful woman in the house. I'm going to turn to Matthew 6. Thank You, Jesus. Hallelujah. So good. Thank You, Jesus. Such a privilege to be in the house of God. Thank You, Jesus. He's an amazing God. His love, so unimaginable, indescribable. I mean, He says, get together and find out. Try and grasp how wide, how deep, how long is His love for us. It's eternal. It goes on forever. It'll never end. It's infinite. He's a good Father. Thank You, Jesus. Matthew 6:1. Ooh. Take care not to do your merciful deeds before men in order to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. We're looking for the reward from the Father. It says it right there. Merciful deeds. Alms. What are you doing in this life for the kingdom? Thank You, Jesus. Take heed that you do not not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Therefore, when you do merciful deeds, do not trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be glorified by men. Truly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you doing merciful deeds, Do not let your left hand know what your right hand does, so that your merciful deeds may be in secret. And your Father, the one seen in secret, himself will repay you in the open. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to skip over to verse 19. Do not treasure up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves dig through and steal. But treasure up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consume and where thieves do not dig through and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Treasure, what you treasure, is what you wrap yourself in, you involve yourself in. What are you spending your time on, your finances on, your thoughts, your waking hours, your sleeping hours? Are they for the kingdom? Man doesn't understand the offering. It doesn't make sense. In the Old Testament, they burned up their best their best animals and their best produce. It just doesn't make sense. But God's on a different scale, you know? He's on a different system. Man is always trying to come up with, how can we do this? That doesn't make sense. Let's invest it. Let's save it. Let's buy a business with it. But God's saying, burn it up. Give it to me. Sacrifice it. Kill it. Give it over to me. When men sees you put in 100, it comes out 0. But God sees you put in 1, it comes out 100.
Yeah.
1,000 more. I'm going to hop over to Mark. Thank you, Jesus. Capitolo 14. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Verse 3. And he being in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, he reclining, a woman came, having an alabaster vial of pure, costly ointment of nard. I don't know how much that breaks down to today's terms, but I know that it says it right there, very costly. And, you know, maybe it's most likely just the very best thing she had. Like, you know, her very best that she could absolutely pull together. I don't know how she got it, but it says, and breaking the alabaster vial, she poured it down on his head. Poured it. She'd spray it, she'd dabble it. She broke it and dumped the whole thing on his head. And it says, and some being indignant with themselves and saying, for what was this waste of the ointment occurred? See, that's the world. The world sees what we do for the kingdom as a waste. You're wasting your Wednesday afternoon and evening. You're wasting a whole day on Sunday. They see it as waste. They're in the men's way of thinking, in the men's system. You know, I don't know what exactly all took place as far as, you know, the whole description of what was said. But it says, for this could be sold for over 300 denarii and to be given to the poor. That's men's system for you. Oh, we could have done this. We could have helped out the poor so they would have, you know, they could have had more shelter or clothing or food or something like that, whatever they needed. And they see that as a benefit, a profit. But what this woman did, she didn't even know what she was doing or what the significance of it. But she gave it, and she was put in 3 of the 4 Gospels. And God is saying, yeah, that's precious. What man sees as a waste, God sees as precious. You know, the things we do for the kingdom are never a waste. Even if you don't see the output. You see, I put all this input, I got nothing output. If your heart was in it and your heart was right, I mean, there's a great reward. The Bible says, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. I mean, that's your spiritual bank account, if you want to think of it like that. But when you get to heaven, what are you going to have? You're going to have to want to come over to Ruth's house, come over to Joshua's house because his is way cooler. No, nothing in heaven is economy class, you know what I'm saying? But man, I don't want to get to heaven and you know, not have much to show for it. You know, like, I want to have the best of the best of the best. And the Bible says, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Nothing that this world sees as common sense. Praise God, we don't live in the natural world. Living by natural thinking. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And they were very angry with her. Jesus said, let her alone. Why do you cause her trouble? She's doing a good work toward me. For the poor you will always have, and you can help them when you want, but you won't always have me. What this one had, she did. That's all. Maybe that's all she had, but that's what she had, and she did it. You know, Jesus is not here today to break our perfume and pour it on him. But there's so many ways that we can do this. Pouring out, that's worship. It's pouring out. Giving the most precious thing that you have and give it to the Lord and watching the Lord do a miracle with it. I mean, it's beautiful. It's trust, it's faith, it's yieldedness. Oftentimes the people that are most yielded are the ones that are most giving. You know, the people that feel they have to keep it in their own power, but that's all they're going to get. They're going to get their results. They're going to get, you know, that which they held on to. But God's continually telling us, be eternally minded. What you're doing every day, the things that you're involving yourself in, is it for the kingdom? Are you eternally minded? Is what you're doing in with perspective of eternity? Is it for the kingdom? Because everything else is going to fade away. It's going to pass. The things we eat, the things we wear, the house we live in, it's all going to pass. But praise God, we have an eternal dwelling. And we have a place with Jesus we're going to spend eternity with, just worshiping and loving him and being around each other, just like churches here right now. We're going to do it for all eternity. Give your temporary to gain the eternal. Just give it up. Why hold on to something that's going to pass? We only got a short amount of time. You're not going to get any more than you already have. We only got a limited amount of time in this life, and the more you give, the more you're going to get in eternity. Thank you, Jesus. So give it all. Give it all tonight. Give your heart. Give your emotions. Give your time. Give your thoughts. Give your prayers. Give your worship to the King. King of Kings, he's worth it. He's worthy. He's worth it. Amen. So just with that and saying, you know, I encourage everybody to prepare an offering and give tonight as an act of worship. God will bless it. He's always looking, how can I bless my kids? Just give them an opportunity. So we love all of you guys. Thanks so much for coming tonight. Did you want to say something? Okay, all right. Well, praise God. Honey? Thank you, Jesus.
There's such a sweet anointing in the house tonight. We're so honored by the Holy Spirit that He would be with us and in us and among us and moving through us. But there's something so special about being in the house of God. There's something so special about the people of God coming together and gathering around the altar of God and coming before the throne of God to worship Him. It's such an honor, it's such a privilege. Too many times we take it for granted. It becomes a part of the routine, a part of the schedule. Sometimes visitors come in and they look, decide if it's their flavor or not. See if it lines up with the scriptures that they've memorized and fit into the way they perceive them and interpret them. You look at the old covenant, the Old Testament. How you had to have the certain look, the certain dress, be of the certain tribe to even come into one of the parts of coming closer to God, to be able to worship God. And the closer you got, the more intense it was, the more responsibility it was. And I just love reading about how they would tie a rope around the priest's ankle just in case he messed up in that holies of holies place. Because they couldn't go in there and go get him if he died, or else they would die too. They would have to pull him out by the ankle. Do we think our God has changed? He is just as intense. He is just as fierce. He is just as holy and loving and passionate and jealous. Oh, what a sweet presence. That He has given an opportunity for us all to come before Him with boldness, with confidence. To come before Him and say, we are holy as You are holy. We are righteous as You are righteous. There is no spot, there is no blemish, there is no stain of sin because we've been covered by Your blood, Lord Jesus. We have been made worthy by Your blood, Lord Jesus. You paid it all so that we were no longer separated from You. We are no longer to be held back from You. There's no longer a veil between us and You. But God, we come before You and we look and behold Your beauty, oh God. Oh, what an honor. What a privilege. Holy Spirit, we're so honored. It's so wonderful that we don't have to live a fleshly life, that we don't have to live a mere natural life. The natural is so boring. And everybody thinks so. You can act all righteous if you want to. Righteous, religious, I should say. But the natural is boring. The flesh is stinky. Why else would all of these movies with all, you know, the sorcery and the, you know, all the different stuff, the Harry Potter, the, you know, the Disney's, all these different ones, why else would they be so popular? Everybody's looking for something more. Everybody's looking for the unseen. How can they have it? And as Christians, we have it. Yet we sit so boring in the house of God. doing nothing with all that God has given us? When's the last time you started testing out, you know, what you have, what God's given to you? Waving your shadow around. Come on. When's the last time you tried to walk on water? When's the last time you tried the impossible? When's the last time you just gave it a shot? It's time to live the impossible, because God is in the impossible. He's in the place where there's no chance that it can look like man. All men are liars. Man is stinky. And if you don't believe that, don't shower for 3 days. And some of you men, it's a couple hours. Woo! You can have a piece of humble pie remembering how stinky man is. But in heaven, your spirit man, you feed that spirit man, that spirit man's alive. It is fresh oil, it is perfume, it is ointment, it is a beautiful smelling sacrifice. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. This isn't my message, but it's for free. I'm sure it's blessing somebody tonight. Amen. So we're just going to read some of the Word of God. I plan to just read a lot of, you know, of the Word. I hope that's okay to read the Word in the house of God. I hope nobody gets bored that I am just going to read straight Word. Amen. You know, I always think it's funny. It was a few years ago, I had brought a friend, and he's like, oh, the preacher didn't open the Bible once. He didn't quote any scripture. You told me that your church was a straight up Word of God church, and he didn't open the Bible one time. He was very contradicting. I'm like, dude, he was quoting nonstop scripture the entire time. I don't even think there was one insertion of his own thing. It was all scripture. I didn't hear any of that. And I was like, well, let me tell you about what the Bible says for those who cannot hear. I'm glad we got some laughs tonight on that one. Anybody, come on. Come on. If you need to go look that up, go look it up. Do it quick so you can come and be a part of us and laugh. Because those who know him, they can hear him. And if you don't know him, you can't hear him. So if you can't hear me, then I don't think you know him. So let's go ahead and get that fixed right now. In Jesus' name, I'll wash you clean in the blood of Jesus Christ. I'll make you whole right now, presentable and acceptable before God. And if you cannot resist it, in Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to talk about one of my favorite people in the Bible. I hope this doesn't embarrass you, Dad, but Elijah reminds me so much of my dad. He's just a radical guy. He's just fully sold out, all out. I mean, he's a man on a mission. There is nothing that gets in the way of this man. He's got laser focus. I mean, you just don't touch Elijah when he's about to do something. Like, the entire earth shakes when he's on a mission, and that's my dad. So Elijah, the Tishbite, you know, you just think of this man that just loves to be out in the wilderness, probably loves to just check on the cows, you know, get on the horseback, bareback, go riding out into sunset, rope a few cows or lambs or something. You know, he's a pastor. That's why I view Elijah. So Elijah the Tishbite, of the sojourn, we're in 1 Kings 17. You all knew that, though, because we're in the house of God. We're in the abiding place. Everybody knows the whole Bible cover to back. I'm prophesying. As Jehovah, the God of Israel, lives before whom I stand, there shall be no dew nor rain these years exceeding according to my word. And the word of Jehovah came to him, saying, Go away from here, you shall turn eastward, and shall hide by the torrent, Cherith, and that is before Jordan. I'm actually going to go to a different translation. Hold on. I don't really like this translation, but it's fun to go and look at different translations as you're reading through. And this one, I think, is just very simple-minded for those of you that are simple-minded as myself. And it really helps me connect the dots. I was born, bred, and raised on the King James Version. And for years of my life, I had no idea what anything was saying. But I memorized it anyways and said, thank you, God, that you give me revelation and that I walk in this all the days of my life. Amen. There's just no excuse, people. The Lord will keep you. When your heart's right, the Lord, he will keep you. He watches over those that are his. Amen. All right, so we're going to read this again. God then told Elijah, get out of here and fast. Head east and hide out at the Cherith Ravine on the other side of the Jordan River. You can drink fresh water from the brook. I've ordered the ravens to feed you. Elijah, let's just hold on there for a second. You can drink fresh water from the brook. I've ordered the ravens to feed you. Elijah obeyed God's orders. He went and camped in the Cherith Canyon on the other side of the Jordan. And sure enough, ravens brought him his meals, both breakfast and supper, and he drank from the brook. Eventually, the brook dried up because of the drought. Then God spoke to him, get up and go to Zarephath in Sidon and live there. I've instructed a woman who lives there, a widow, to feed you. So he got up and went to Zarephath. As he came to the entrance of the village, he met a woman, a widow, gathering firewood. He asked her, please, would you bring a little water in a jug? I need a drink. As she went to get it, he called out, and while you're at it, would you bring me something to eat? She said, I swear, as surely as God lives, I don't have so much as a biscuit. I have a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a bottle. You found me scratching together just enough firewood to make a last meal for my son and me. We will eat and then we will die. Talk about attitude. This woman was like, come on. We're going to eat and then we're going to die. Talk about not a positive, Polly. She's making her point, though. She sees this wild man and she's just like, first, you want me to get you water, but because I'm a woman and you're a man, I'm going to go ahead and get you some water. And now you're asking me for a biscuit, too. Elijah said to her, don't worry about a thing. Go ahead and do what you've said. But first, make a small biscuit for me and bring it back here. Then go ahead, make a meal from what's left for you and your son. This is the word God of Israel. The jar of flour will not run out, and the bottle of oil will not become empty before God sends rain on this land and ends the drought. Can I get an amen on this? If you think about this for a second, we're just going to pause here for a second. I keep pausing, hoping to let it just kind of soak in, but I just got to stop here. God will always take care of you when you keep his things first. When you take care of the man of God above your needs, he will supernaturally provide for you above and beyond what you could ever think or ask. He never leaves you or forsakes you when you're about the master's business. There's no proof or evidence of that. Nowhere. So people have their experiences and their opinions. It's just not so. God always takes care of the people who keep his things first. Yes. Amen. Yes. And she went right off and did just as Elijah asked, and it turned out as he had said. Daily food for her for her and her family. The jar of meal didn't run out, and the bottle of oil didn't become empty. God's promise fulfilled to the letter exactly as Elijah had delivered it. But you have to understand that woman had a choice right there. She could have decided, forget this man, I don't even know him, he's a stranger. And she could have gone on her way and made her biscuit for her son and herself and died. Or she could have obeyed what the man had said. But here's the thing. We don't know that this lady even knew who Elijah was. We didn't know if she knew that he was a man of God. But she received his word in faith. She honored that word in faith. You have to understand. Faith is the currency of heaven. And when you honor faith, God will honor you. Thank you, Jesus. Well, that kind of went over a little bit like a wet blanket, but thank you, Jesus. We'll just continue on. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Have you been honoring the man of God? How do you honor the man of God? This isn't my sermon. I just feel it. Too many of us, we're honoring ourselves all the time. Is there anybody in your life that you truly honor? We'll start there. I love journaling. I always tell the youth, you need to journal. You need it no matter how weird or whatever you think it is, how girly it is, have a diary, dear diary. It is a requirement in youth to have a journal because I believe that you constantly have to be evaluating your life. You constantly have to be measuring your life. And if you can't write it down, then it doesn't exist. If you can't write it down of what is actually going on in your life, pinpoint it, bullet it, whatever you like, paragraph it, epistle it, as some like to do, and there be evidence, then it doesn't exist. And also being able to put prayers before the Lord and writing them out, putting vision before the Lord, continually brewing over it. In different assignments like this one, how are you honoring people around you? Even more so, how are you honoring leadership? How are you honoring the man of God? How are you honoring God? You can't tell me you honor God when you don't even make it to the Sunday morning service. Because all the rest is just a fantasy. Because where are the places that you can tangibly grab a hold of, bullet point it, this is what I'm doing to honor God. This is what I'm doing to honor the man of God. So anyways, we're going to keep going. If you're wondering why you haven't had an encounter with God, I tell you there's some things in your life you need to clean up. Because my Bible says, the pure in heart, they'll see God. The pure in heart, they'll have an encounter with God. These daily encounters with God that we should be having, it's not to condemn you. It's not to make you all upset and hurt. It's to say, hey, hold on. That's what my Bible says too. There's some things that I need to clean up in my life. Holy Spirit, show me what they are. And you just ask the Holy Spirit and you continue right along. Holy Spirit, show me what is in my life that I need to clean up. I don't want anything that blocks me from having my daily encounters with God. I don't know how you live like that. Later on, the woman's son became sick. The sickness took a turn for worse, and then he stopped breathing. Look at this woman. This woman is crazy. The woman said to Elijah, "Why did you ever show up here in the first place? A holy man barging in, exposing my sins and killing my son." They've been living off of a supernatural supply from heaven. From the word that Elijah spoke, she received it in faith. And now she's rebuking him for ever coming. She's like, "It would have been better that we just died." But I think there's a secret about this woman. I think she's one of those ladies that just likes to provoke a man to good works. Some men really need provoking for them to actually get up off the couch and do something. And I think that this lady's very strategic with that. She wasn't just crazy in her own way. But she was going after provoking Elijah. Because she saw something in this man. Elijah says, "Hand me your son." I'm sure Elijah was busy. He's a man on a mission. He's always got something going on. But now he's provoked. She did it. He then took her from her bosom, carried him up to the loft where he was staying, and laid him on his bed. Then he prayed, "O God, my God, why have you brought this terrible thing on this widow who has opened her home to me? Why have you killed her son?" He knows he's in trouble. This lady has some fire in her eyes, put some fear of God in Elijah, and Elijah's like, "Oh, shoot." He knows that all hell is about to break loose if something doesn't happen with this woman's son. You know how there's just some women, they walk the earth and everything shakes. And hell has no fury like this woman. Right? There's some women that are just like that. Anybody met them? 3 times, he stretched himself out full length on the boy, praying with all of his might. "God, my God, put breath back into this boy's body. God, listen to Elijah's prayer and put breath back in his body," and he was alive. Come on. Elijah picked up the boy, carried him downstairs from the loft, and gave him to his mother. "Here's your son," Elijah said, "alive." The woman said, "Elijah, I see it all now. You are a holy man. When you speak, God speaks a true word." Oh, it's so good. We're going to go to the next chapter because this is just this part of the Bible, this little section. It's just you can't stop in little sections of it. It's just so good. You got to get the whole picture, right? So well, let's go to 18. I hope nobody's bored. Amen. If you're bored, I just want to release you right now. You are welcome at any time to go ahead. The exit's right there. No hard feelings. But you're not walking out on me. You're walking out on the Word of God. You're walking out on the Holy Spirit. That's on you. A long time passed. Then God's word came to Elijah. The drought was now in its 3rd year. The message, "Go and present yourself to Ahab. I'm going to make it rain on the country." Elijah set out to present himself to Ahab. The drought in Samaria at the time was most severe. Ahab called for Obadiah, who was in charge of the palace. Obadiah feared God. He was very devout. Earlier, when Jezebel had tried to kill off all the prophets of God, Obadiah had hidden away 100 of them in 2 caves, 50 in a cave, and then supplied them with food and water. Old Jezzy, she's back. You know that Jezebel still works to this day. She still has rule and reign in the church, which is just crazy to think about. How on earth could that witch be so present? But when we don't honor the things that we should honor, when we're just out doing our thing, that's the spirit of Jezebel. When we're not willing to submit to leadership, we're not willing to just say, hey, pastor, how do you feel about this? Or when pastor says, hey, you know what? If this isn't bringing the law, shut it down. You just got cut off from the covering, and now you're under spirit of Jezebel when you continue on those things, right? That was just said Sunday. We always want to be listening to those things to make sure we stay under the covering of the house. Old Jezzy. Obadiah went his way, and suddenly there he was, Elijah. Obadiah fell on his knees, bowing in reverence, and exclaimed, is it really you, my master Elijah? Yes, said Elijah, the real me. Now go and tell your boss, I've seen Elijah. It's a great translation, I know. Obadiah said, but what have I done to deserve this? Ahab will kill me. As surely as your God lives, there isn't a country or kingdom where my master hasn't sent out search parties looking for you. And if they said, we can't find him, we've looked high and low, he would make that country or kingdom swear that you had not been found. And now you're telling me, go and tell your master Elijah's found? I think this is funny because here he is. He's like giving his reasoning why he doesn't deserve to die. Look what I did. I hid the prophets in the cave and I gave them bread and water. Surely you're not going to still send me to die. Right? He's trying to justify himself here. Giving his story time. The minute I leave you, the Spirit of God will whisk you away to who knows where. Then when I report to Ahab, you'll have disappeared and Ahab will kill me. And I've served God devoutly since I was a boy. Hasn't anyone told you what I did when Jezebel was out to kill the prophets of God? How I risked my life by hiding 100 of them, 50 to a cave, and made sure they had food and water? At least he's got a good excuse to be pleading for his life to Elijah. Some of us do the same thing to God and we're like not even doing anything. And it's not even really risking our life. It's like, hey, go tell somebody about the good news of salvation. But my laundry, it will get stinky if it stays an extra hour. You know, like we have these stupid excuses. We don't put them like that. If we were to actually like put it out in words. But really. And now you are telling me to draw attention to myself by announcing to my master, Elijah's been found. Why? He'll kill me for sure. Elijah said, as surely as God of the hosts lives and before whom I take my stand, I'll meet with your master face to face to this very day. So Obadiah went straight to Ahab and told him, and Ahab went out to meet Elijah. It's not I who, I skipped a verse. It's important. The moment Ahab saw Elijah, he said, so it's you, you old troublemaker. It's so good because Ahab and Jezebel, there's a lot of similarities of the world's church today. By the world's church, I mean church up the road. Or maybe even in your own life. We're so mad that the preacher would say that we can live without sin. We're so mad that the preacher would tell us to live by faith and not by sight. We're so mad that the preacher would tell us to go heal the sick, go cure the diseased, go cast out devils. We're all looking at the preacher like, oh, you troublemaker. Just let us sit in the pew and worship God how we want to and interpret the Bible how we want to and live our life as we want to. Live and let live. Que sera, sera. Whatever to be is to be. We want no responsibility. So if you have that in your life, you can say, hold on. That's Ahab and Jezebel. I just rebuke Ahab and Jezebel tonight in Jesus' name so that we can all say, I'm not of Ahab and Jezebel. My Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for your power and for your anointing over this word that seizes every heart tonight, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. It's not I who has caused trouble in Israel, said Elijah, but you and your government. You've dumped God's ways and commands and run off after the local gods, the Baals. Here's what I want you to do. Assemble everyone in Israel at Mount Carmel and make sure that the special pets of Jezebel, the 450 prophets, this is the Message Bible, so you've got to forgive me a little bit, give a little of open interpretation here. And make sure the special pets of Jezebel, the 450 prophets of the local gods, I don't know if it's Baals or Baals, whatever, somebody who's really good in the Greek or Hebrew or Aramaic can just say what it is, if you know. Baal. Thank you, David, the Hebrew scholar. And the 400 prophets of the whore goddess Asherah are there. So Ahab summoned everyone in Israel, particularly the prophets, to Mount Carmel. Elijah challenged the people. How long are you going to sit on the fence? If God is the real God, follow him. If it is Baal, follow him. Make up your minds. Nobody said a word and nobody moved. Then Elijah said, I'm the only prophet of God left in Israel. And there are 450 of Baal. Let the Baal prophets bring up two oxen. Let them pick one, butcher it, and lay it out on the altar of firewood. But don't ignite it. I'll take the other ox, cut it up, lay it on the wood, but neither will I light the fire. Then you pray to your gods, and I'll pray to my God. The God who answers with fire will prove to be, in fact, God. I love preaching this one to Hindus. They get to relate because all their gods are just Baals. Theirs is more tangible. You've got your Baals. Some women, it's makeup. They cannot go where God has called them to go because they can't go out the door without makeup. That's an idol. Or finances, or these other different place things that we make gods. Some people, they're little trinkets in their house, their plates or their statues or these different things. I can't go to the mission field, my plates. It's all just as stupid. You know, come on. Maybe you don't have your plates, but you probably have something else. We just want to go ahead and give that to the Lord tonight. Renounce that. Burn it. Throw it out. Smash it. Okay. So, and the people agreed. a good plan. Do it. Elijah told the Baal prophets, choose your ox and prepare it. You go first. You are the majority. Then pray to your God, but don't light the fire. So they took the ox he had given them, prepared it for the altar, then prayed to Baal. They prayed all morning long. Oh, Baal, answer us. But nothing happened, not so much as a whisper of breeze. Desperate, they jumped and stomped on the altar they had made. You gotta just, I love pictures, I love visuals, I love drawing and doodling and kind of painting the picture, you know? And so you have to put yourself in the place. Okay, in this moment in time in history, where are you? Are you up in a tree watching? Are you one of the Baal priests? Are you hanging out as one of the people that didn't say anything? You know, where are you in this moment in history? Does anybody like to people watch? I love people watching. It is so fascinating to me. It's one of my favorite things about going to Disneyland. I'll literally just sit on a bench, get a turkey leg, and just sit. And I am fully entertained. Anyways, I don't know if that's of the Holy Spirit or not, but... So... picture yourself. So you see these guys. They're crying out, oh, Baal, answer us. But nothing's happening. They're jumping around. They're stomping. Just think, these crazy guys, they're in their robes. They've probably got like some gold and crowns. Because I bet Jezebel, she's probably someone, she's always, you know, kind of depicted as like the blue eyeshadow. And she's always got a lot going on and stuff. So I would imagine if she's kind of running the show here, she's probably got these guys all pumped up on their ego. She's probably got them in certain robes and certain golds and different things like that. So imagine these silly gooses out there stomping, jumping, screaming. Okay. By noon, Elijah had started making fun of them, taunting, call a little louder. People, you have to understand, God has such a sense of humor. He is an intense God of fire, but he is a God of just hilarious love and kindness and joy and peace. I mean, I just imagine heaven where it's just like, it's all like your bestest friends and families. Everybody's poking at one another and everybody's just stoked out of their minds on the fun and adventures and just the constant joy and worshiping of God. I don't know what you think heaven is, but that's just kind of what I imagine. I don't really know that I have enough scripture to back it up, but you go with yours, I'll go with mine. Okay? So, I just love this. Here Elijah is. He's just being like a silly, call a little louder. He is a God after all. Maybe he's off meditating somewhere. Maybe he's gotten involved in a project. Maybe he's on vacation. Like, he's just being nonsensical and silly to make them angry. You don't suppose he overslept, do you? Does he need to be woken up? They prayed louder and louder. They start cutting themselves with swords and knives, a ritual common to them until they were covered with blood. I mean, this is crazy. This is absolutely crazy. This is straight out of Africa. We were in Africa, my sister and I, and we pulled up to this village because I think the leader just had like this stirring in his heart, like we were supposed to kind of turn off this road. He comes up to this house. There's this witch doctor there, and they are right in the middle of doing the ceremony for making their new witch doctors and having some kind of partation. And they were dancing around with chickens and ripping them off and doing all this thing, dumping the blood all over and putting the wings, getting all in the dirt. I mean, it's just crazy. We call it TIA. This is Africa. Like, that's how you explain everything. If you have no idea what's going on, you just say, this is Africa. Like, you know? So it's just crazy stuff. And so they're cutting themselves and blood is squirting everywhere. And it's just, I mean, it's just hideous. It's just disgusting. Who wants to even be a part of that? But so many of us are. When we're just allowing the world to just sweep us in its things. It's nothing more than this blood ritual. This went on until well past noon. They used every religious trick and strategy they knew to make something happen on the altar, but nothing happened. Not so much as a whisper or a flicker or a response. Then Elijah told the people, "Enough of that, it's my turn. Gather around." And they gathered. And then put the altar back together. He then put the altar back together, for by now it was in ruins. Elijah took 12 stones, one for each of the tribes of Jacob, the same Jacob of who God had said, "From now on, your name is Israel." He built the stones into the altar in honor of God. Then Elijah dug a fairly wide trench around the altar. He laid firewood on the altar, cut up the ox, put it on the wood, and said, "Fill 4 buckets with water and drench both the ox and firewood." Then he said, "Do it again." And they did it. Any of you buddy know, anybody like to camp, anybody light a fire before? Come on, you city folks, get out in the wilderness. Shoot. You don't dump water on firewood you're about to start. You just don't do that. That's how you don't get the wood to light. But he's making a point here. God is a God of impossible. He loves the impossible. It's like, come on, Elijah, do it again. Dump some more water. Do it again so they really get it, that it's really drenched in water. Okay, now do it again. Do it a third time. They did it a third time. The altar was drenched and the trench was filled with water. This is impossible to light. This is impossible for man to light. When it was time for the sacrifice to be offered, Elijah the prophet came up and prayed, "O God, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, make it known right now that you are God in Israel, that I am your servant, and that I'm doing, and that what I'm doing under your orders, answer me, God. Oh, answer and reveal to this people that you are God, the true God, and that you are giving these people another chance of repentance." So much of what God does in an open situation like that, where he's saying, "Look it, God, show that you're real. Show that I'm your servant." He didn't have to say that. He did that for the benefit of the people, so they could understand what was happening, because Elijah's best friends with God. He's walking with God. He's constantly getting translated. I mean, we don't know all the things that Elijah got to do when he was here on this earth. I mean, he was walking so close with God. He's one of the great examples, you know. The people, they want to walk the line of how close can they walk with the world and still be saved? How close can they look like the world but not be of the world? As opposed to Elijah, who is a great model, was saying, how close can I be walking to God and still be on this earth? That was the line he was straddling. What line are you straddling? Are you straddling the line of the world of how much can I kind of fit in and conform and not be making too much of a stir and not be too confrontational or extreme? Or are you on the other side like Elijah, trying to straddle how much can I get into heaven but still be on this earth too? I mean, that's a powerful revelation. Where are you at? So he's making this open prayer like this, and this open show, so to speak, for the opportunity of men to see who God is, the real God, and have a chance of repentance. God is continually calling all men to repentance. He's constantly giving all different times, different demonstrations, different miracles for men to come and repent and know who God is, who the living God is. We are without excuse. We are absolutely without excuse. Immediately, the fire of God fell and burned up the offering, the wood, the stones, the dirt, even the water in the trench. All the people saw and fell on their faces in awe and worshiped, exclaiming, "God is the true God. God is the true God." Elijah grabbed the the Baal prophets, don't let one get away. They grabbed them. Elijah had taken them down to the brook of Kishon, and they massacred the lot. Elijah said to Ahab, up on your feet, eat and drink, celebrate. Rain is on the way. I hear it coming. Ahab did it, got up, ate and drank. Meanwhile, Elijah climbed up to the top of Carmel, bowed deeply in prayer, his face between his knees. Then he said to his young servant, on your feet now, look toward the sea. Elijah didn't go and celebrate after what victory had just happened. He went and prayed. You see the same thing that Jesus did. When there was great signs and wonders, great displays of miracles, Jesus didn't go celebrate with the people. He went and prayed. No, Siri, I rebuke you. He went and looked and reported back. I don't see a thing. Keep looking, said Elijah. 7 times if necessary. That's faith right there. He's saying, don't you dare stop until you see it. I don't care if you're going to be here all day running back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. We're not stopping until you see it. This is such a great example of faith. How many times were we just, oh, we don't see it, and we give up what we were going for in God? We held one meeting, and it didn't happen how we thought it was going to happen, so then we're like, oh, God's not in it. We talked to one person, and they didn't fall on their knees and repent. We must not be preachers. God must have called somebody else. I guess I'm to do something else. No, this is how faith is. Don't stop till you see it. Don't keep exhausting yourself until it happens. Who knows how long he had to run? I don't know. Does any of our Bible scholars know? Does it say? Did I miss that? I don't know. If you know, you can tell us all later. Keep looking, said Elijah, 7 times if necessary. So this guy's running back and forth, and sure enough, on the 7th time, he had to go all the way to the 7 times, all the way to the very end. Sure enough, 7th time he said, oh yes, a cloud, but a very small cloud, no bigger than someone's hand, rising out of the sea. Another negative Nancy here. Just wants to make sure he's not exaggerating. Quickly then, on your way. Tell Ahab, saddle up, get down from the mountain before the rain stops you. Elijah's such a man of authority. It's radical. Things happened fast. The sky grew black with wind-driven clouds, and then a huge cloud burst of rain. With Ahab hightailing it in his chariot for Jezreel, and God strengthened Elijah mightily. Pulling up his robe and tying it around his waist, Elijah ran in front of Ahab's chariot until he reached Jezreel. So I want to go back to chapter 17 here, where it's talking about the brook. My son's trying to preach. He's a prophet. The Lord showed me that boy when I was 8 years old. Fulfilled every one of his promises. I won't start bragging about my son because he's a perfect child. He's the best child, so don't want to stir anybody up. But we look at where Elijah, so God moves him out, and he's saying, look, I'm moving you to this next season in life, so to speak. I'm going to feed you. There's going to be provision. You're going to be fed, your meals, your breakfast, your supper. And I'm going to give you water. And the drought hadn't finished, but yet the brook had dried up. God was doing something here with Elijah. And I like to be creative with the scriptures. I hope I don't get too creative and get in trouble, but the Holy Spirit, he'll correct me. He always does. But I like to look at this as being Elijah gets in this place, he's out of the city, and he's back in his happy place of just being in the wilderness, being alone with God. I mean, I imagine that he was able to just be stepping into the unseen realm, that he was truly having days of heaven where he was at. Just all alone in the presence of God in the wilderness. The ravens are bringing his meals. He's not having to go hunting. The water is right there where he's encamped about. And God dried it up because there was a new season that Elijah had to go through. And I believe Elijah had gotten comfortable where he was at in that season of provision. And the brook dried up, and it was just a way of God saying, hey, Elijah, it's time to move. And many times we find ourselves getting stuck in a season we were never supposed to get stuck in. And the provision runs out, and we're like, what now? And rather than realizing, okay, God, this is new direction, and being vigilant and aware of seeking God, okay, what's the direction where to go to? A lot of us get into a pity party. Oh, I'm poor now. I'm suffering with Christ. I guess I'm supposed to just be poor. It's just the way it is. And you kind of bemoan and you kind of revel in that season when all God's doing is saying, look it, that was for a time and a place, and now I have something new for you. It's time for you to move forward. It's time for you to be aware and seek my face for that direction to go ahead. You think Elijah, when he was in the city, when he was in the town, he was under immense persecution. And now out in the wilderness, it's all good times. There's nobody to be throwing stones at him, wanting to kill him, right? So you can see how it would be really easy to just, for him to get on a horse and rope a cow and be content for the rest of his life. But there's no retirement plan in God on this earth. There just isn't. It doesn't exist anywhere in the Bible. There is no evidence of that. And so you see, so all of a sudden the brook dries up. This was the blessing of the Lord that is now gone. Not because Elijah did something wrong. Not because he sinned and God's a God who takes away our favorite things because we did something bad. So now we're going to get, I don't know the words. I'm not very good with English. Yes, thank you. I'm good with the Holy Spirit language. Not English. But thank you, Jesus. He is our strength through all things. In our weakness, we are made in our weakness, he is made strong. Amen. We have to look and see, how comfortable have we become? Are we too comfortable right now? I always get worried when things are going really good. Ma's like, okay, Lord, did I miss it? And that's just immature, because I'm still growing in the things of God. But I'm always concerned, because I want to make sure we're to stay always on that discomfort, that unfamiliar, always venturing for more in God. Always in uncharted territories with the things of God. And it's rejoicing and it's good and it's wonderful. And it's a place of blessing. But I always want to evaluate, okay, God, have we gotten too comfortable? Because we're not here to just burn out our days until we, one day in the far, far future, we make it to heaven. We're here to labor, and we're here to labor hard. So you look, God had more assignments for him. He dried at the brook, and then he had to go to the widow. And then from the widow, where their family was taken care of, raised the son from the dead. We don't know what all happened with that family, all because of Elijah going there, but that was strategic, an assignment given to him from God. And then he got to stay there for a season. And then once again, it was time to move. And then we have the assignment of Baal and all the things that God did there. God takes us through seasons. And we are continually moving forward in seasons. And I want you to ask yourself, to evaluate yourself. Am I moving from season to season, or have I become stuck in something that I'm not supposed to still be in? Was this a season that was good for yesterday, but it's not good for today? We have to be evaluating ourselves. Because if you're not evaluating yourself to the Word of God now, then you are going to be caught off guard when you meet in the throne room of God presenting your life. And you don't want to be that. I want to come before the throne of God knowing exactly what's expected, so to speak. Where I'm not just flying by the seat of my pants. I knew where I was serving. I knew where I was valiant. I knew where I was taking ground in the things of God. We're not just flying passively by waiting for a bird in the sky and, you know, hoping one day that things will get better. One day I'm going to reach millions of people, but yet I'm just sitting on the seat doing nothing. I'm not even entering in. I'm usually bored just checking out my fingernails or my toes. They've never become so interesting than in that moment when I'm sitting in church. How are you engaging to advance the kingdom of heaven in every situation of your life, especially when you come into the house of God? How are you taking ground when you come in to worship before the King of Kings, the Almighty God, saying, "This is my preparation time"? Not being bored, but actively engaging in the things of God, knowing that the Spirit is doing a work far more than you could ever know or understand. When you're engaging in the things of God, when you're engaging in worship, when you're engaging in the message, when you're engaging in the intimacy of the Father, engaging in the Word, it's a preparation for the next season. And if you're not being diligent with the season that you're in, you're going to stay stuck. And you will die in stuck. You will die in delay. Thank you, Jesus. God needs you and your anointing in other places. We are continually to be ministers of the Word of God. Sometimes it's in San Diego. Sometimes it's in another place of the world. Sometimes it's in your family. Sometimes it's in your school. Sometimes it's in your work. Where there's strategic assignments, there's strategic people each day. Thank you, Jesus. God loves giving us seasons of fruitfulness and flourishing. He loves giving us seasons of blessings. But we have to understand there's also John 15. There's seasons of trying and proving. There's seasons of those of us who are fruitful to have an even greater fruitfulness. Sometimes your provision of now, it's got to dry up to get your attention. Don't bemoan it. Don't ask why. Know that you're coming out of one season going into a next, that you're getting a promotion, that you're getting an upgrade. And now it's time to seek God more vigilantly. Those are times when you feel yourself shifting in another seasons. Those are good times to fast and pray before God. To make sure that you're being sensitive to the Spirit of God to know the direction He's calling you in now. We think we haven't arrived at the promise and think it would just take one season long. But to get there, you can see there's multiple seasons in receiving the promise. I like to use a really simple example of Amazon. Everybody's familiar with Amazon. You go, you look for what you want. You click, you pay, you choose your shipping, or you shipping, pay. Then it sends it to the factory. Then they have to box it. Then they have to put it in the mail. And then it's going to come from truck to truck and get to you. Those are all different seasons to finally get the promise. Is anybody tracking with what I'm saying here? Sometimes there's 2-hour shipping. Sometimes there's two-day shipping. Sometimes there's a week shipping. Or if you're doing Zulily, it can take a month or two. But understand what I'm saying here. There's fruitfulness and there's blessing in certain seasons. And then there's times for you to move forward and go. Get up and go. Pack up and go. There's time to live in great abundance and wealth. Sometimes there's time where it's like, okay, God, we're really stretched right now. But we're living by faith and we're not going to stop. We're going for greater and higher. Because if you continue on, you don't slow up. When you hit that spot of stretching, you do not slow up. You hit it harder. You spend more. And by spend more, I mean in the kingdom of God. You labor more in the kingdom of God. It's a flashing red sign that says, get working harder. Batten down the hatches. Go for more. Get working harder in the things of God. Go, go. Labor, labor, labor. Run, run, run. That's all that is. And you cannot, when you hit those places where you're feeling stretch, you get down. You get down and serious and laboring in the things of God. You do not let up. You do not stop. Because I promise you before all of heaven, the breakthrough is right there. In the moment where you feel like there's no way that it's going to come through, that you're so stretched, you're so exhausted, I promise you, you don't give up. It's just around the corner, so to speak. It's right there, and he will come through, and you will break through into that next season of abundance and fruitfulness and blessing. When it's all about the kingdom, God is faithful. He takes care of his children more than you could ever think or know. If it's about the kingdom's business, there will not be lack. You press in, you run harder, you labor more, and it will be there. Amen. And I'm not just saying that because somebody told me that or I read it in the scriptures, even though I believe it so, because the word of God is forever faithful. It is true. It's also happened in my own life. You must run. You must. So many people, they stop short right before the breakthrough. They give up. Too exhausted. They can't see it. They feel. It's called the false finish line. You don't let up. In Jesus' name, by the Holy Spirit and power right now, every person in this place will never again stop short. In Jesus' name. It's time to go from the familiar to the unfamiliar. So what if you fail? You don't quit. You just don't quit. You keep going. You keep going. You do it better. You do it harder. You run faster. In Jesus' name. And it's not even you. It's not about you. It's not in your strength. You turn to the Holy Spirit in everything. Every area of your life, you have to look to the Father. You say, Holy Spirit, how do you feel about this? Holy Spirit, how do you feel what I'm doing about? How do you feel about what I'm doing now? In every situation, even a job. Holy Spirit, can I take this job? Every situation, ask the Holy Spirit. Come on. One of my favorite quotes outside of the Word of God, I know some people won't approve. It's from Napoleon Bonaparte. Who possibly my husband might be related to. It's hesitation and half measures lose everything in war. I love that quote. Just think about it for a second. Hesitation and half measures lose everything in war. If you haven't noticed, we're on a battlefield, brother. Sister. It is a battle to take ground for the things of God. And if you don't feel the battle, well, get busy. I mean, it's a place of rejoicing. It's a place of adventure and fun, right? I mean, we're not all bogged down. I mean, people are walking around, oh, Satan's doing that, he's doing this. It's like, dude, you're worshiping Satan all the time. You're giving him credit, and Satan's over there like, I didn't do that, but okay. That was all you, man. Stop giving Satan so much credit and just start worshiping the Father. Just keep your eyes on Jesus in everything. Give thanks to Jesus in everything. You break out in a rash. I thank you, Jesus, that I don't have this rash. I'm healed in Jesus' name. You know, whatever it is, your toenail, whatever it is, I'm trying to come down to the level here on the simplest things. He counts the hairs of your head. He cares about your rash or whatever it is. I'm praying right now, anybody that's got a rash is going to get healed right now in Jesus' name. No longer can we delay or we will die in delay. If Elijah would have stayed where the brook dried up, he would have probably died because he wasn't listening. He was getting out of a place of, well, maybe not. I mean, but I'm just saying, we love Elijah. God loves Elijah, but he loves you too. But if he didn't obey, he probably would have died. It would have been the end for him. That was his retirement program, maybe. He's like, okay, I'm left with maybe a couple cows. We're going to watch him, keep him. And in 20 years, I'm probably going to die. Or less, because he didn't have water. So, if you don't have a vision, you need to go fast and pray. Get alone with the intent of, I'm not leaving until I get vision from you, God. Go with the intent of, I will die if that's what it takes until I get vision from God. Because when you get serious with God, he's going to get serious with you. And if it's not life and death to you, then it's really not that big of a deal. Have you ever gotten that serious with God? Have you ever said to God, God, I'm not moving from this place. I don't care whether I live or whether I die. You have to give me this. I have to have vision according to your will and purpose and plan. I remember going through a season of my life where I just got out in the wilderness, had my backpack, my water pack, packed my little sleeping bag, and I just charted out on the ranch. I hate coyotes, and there's a lot of them, like deathly fear. Like, I would rather charge a lion than a coyote. I know it's stupid. It makes no sense. Same with spiders. I hate them. Like, I will go to Kashmir with all of the people shooting at each other. No problem. Feel peace. Take a nap. But a spider comes around, and I've really got to, like, go after it in the things of God and get myself infused with the courage of the Lord. I know. It's weird. And I charred out, and I just got in the dirt, my face in the dirt, and it was just, God, I don't want to take another breath unless you fill me with vision. I don't want to take another breath unless my life will count for your kingdom, oh God. I don't want to move from this place unless I know that I will take ground in the things of God, that I will live valiantly for the things of God, that I will fulfill everything that you have for my life in this earth. When you get serious with God, he'll get serious with you. I promise you, don't move until something gets birthed straight out of heaven inside of your spirit. We are not living just flying by the seat of our pants, hoping for a coincidence to happen and we're going to get a couple souls saved. That is not how we are to live. Lord Jesus. I mean, a vision is something you just can't shake it. You think about it every day. It doesn't matter how far you have to go. It doesn't matter how far you run away from it. You can't get away from it because it's birthed deep on the inside of you. It's of God. That's what I mean by go fast and pray and don't stop until with the intent of I'm going to die unless I get something from God. That's what I mean. You can't shake it. You can't get away from it. Don't move until you have a dream, a vision, destiny, birthed in your spirit. This kind of vision from God, you can't delay it. You cannot delay. We examine our day-to-day lives. We must ask ourselves, do I thirst for God? Do you wake up in the morning? Do you thirst for God? Do you have an unquenchable desire for him that cannot be satisfied by anything else. My love for my husband, my love for my son, it's just, you don't understand it until you have it, right? It's just something happens. Especially when you bring a kid in the world. It's like, our love did that. You know, it's just incredible. It's just something that the Lord gave us the privilege of participating in. It's so beautiful. It's so wonderful. But yet there's nothing that he can do. And there's nothing my son can do for me that can fill a place in my life. It's a place that only God can fill. There's only so much that he can do. So many marriages, they break because you're looking for something that each other can't provide. Only God can provide it. And this vision in God, you have to have this birthed in your spirit to know I'm living valiantly for the kingdom of God. It's not hard because God's just waiting for you. He's like, come on, how bad do you want it? Just seek me. Because I'm on pins and needles to give it to you. But I have to know that you're going to be responsible with it. You're irresistible to God when you're seeking him in faith, in truth. You're absolutely irresistible. Thank you, Jesus. You know, you see Joshua 14, 12 through 15, he says, declare now, therefore, give me this mountain, the valiancy of these men. And God says, go to 2 Corinthians 12, 19, or sorry, 12, 9. Thank you, Jesus. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all more gladly about my weakness so that God's power may rest on me. Let's go back to Elijah in 1 Kings 19. I hope this message is sobering. It wasn't a message to tickle anybody. It's sobering. Having vision birthed out of heaven. How many people are actually seeking God like that? Come on. Come on. It's not about just feeling good and getting some fast food Taco Bell from God. And hoping we have a smile on our face the next day. God is so much more. And it's almost crude to even parallel that or compare that. Because God is so much more. We are to live for so much more in the things of God. And it's so fun, it's so adventurous. Your life's so much better. I mean, how many of you guys know some of your friends from high school? Like, what are they doing? But what are you doing? Like, time to get having some fun. Like, join in the fun. Join in the adventure. Join in the fight. It's a fun fight. You just see things, and it's just like, whoa. Like casting out demon spirits. Come on. What? Some of you need to get on the form field or something because you're talking to too many religious people that are way too good at tucking in their crazy. And Ahab told Jezzy all that Elijah did. Shoot. And all that he killed, all the prophets by the sword. I'm going to go back to my message translation. Jezebel immediately sent a message to Elijah with her threat. The gods will get you for this, and I'll get even with you. By this time tomorrow, you'll be as dead as any one of those prophets. When Elijah saw how things were, he ran for dear life to Beersheba, far in the south of Judah. He left his young servant there and then went on into the desert another day's journey. He came to a lone broom bush and collapsed in its shade, wanting in the worst way to be done with it all, to just die. Enough of this, God. Take my life. I'm ready to join my ancestors in the grave. Exhausted, he fell asleep under the lone broom bush. When's the last time you were exhausted for the things of God? I mean exhausted, not like, where's my friend Josh? Not like Puerto Rican exhausted. I mean like you worked like an animal for the things of God and you're exhausted. Lord Jesus, I just ask you to come and get everybody drunk in this place tonight. I was writing this message so drunk, the things of God, and it was so funny. And now I'm in here like, wait, what? What? Y'all too serious. You're looking to your strength to make this happen. It's God. God does it. You just say, Holy Spirit, I want that. I need that. Come fill me now. And you carry on. I mean, if it doesn't keep you in the place of rejoicing, then don't leave that place. Stay rejoicing until you're mature enough to ask God for more in the things of God, and you can keep rejoicing. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Oh, my. Holy Spirit, right now in Jesus' name, drunk like a Brad Scott drunk and a Robin or Randy drunk. If you need a model of what drunk looks like, just look at them when they get drunk. Oh, thank you, Father. So Elijah saw how things were and he ran for dear life. Enough of this, God, take my life. I'm ready to join the ancestors in the grave. Exhausted, he fell asleep. Suddenly an angel shook him awake and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and to his surprise, right by his head was a loaf of bread baked on some coals and a jug of water. He ate the meal, and he went back to sleep. Elijah's roasted. He's done. He's like, I've spent my whole life about your business, God. I've worked like an animal. I've been hightailing it out of Dodge, getting away from Jesse as fast as I can. I'm over it. Father, just take me up. It's good. I've served my purpose. I lived valiantly for your kingdom, and he did. He's been living valiantly, and he's done. He's sick of running from his life from crazy Jesse. So he's like, fine, I'll eat, and he goes back to sleep. The angel of God came back and shook him again and said, get up and eat some more. You've got a long journey ahead of you. He got up, ate, drank his fill, and set out. Nourished by that meal, he walked 40 days and nights all the way to the mountain of God, to Horeb. When he got there, he crawled into a cave and he went back to sleep. When you're depressed, all you want to do is sleep. You've got no motivation for your life. You can't see the day of dawn. It's like life just turns to black and white. There's no more color. You're just fed up. It's just over. So he crawled into a cave and he went to sleep. Then the word of God came to him. Elijah, what are you doing? And you look at Elijah,
I've been working my heart out for the God of the angel army, said Elijah. The people of Israel have abandoned your covenant, destroyed the places of worship, murdered your prophets. I'm the only one left, and now they're trying to kill me. Then he was told, go, stand on the mountain at attention before God. God will pass by. A hurricane of wind ripped through the mountains and shattered the rocks before God, but God wasn't to be found in the wind. After the wind, an earthquake, but God wasn't found in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, fire, but God wasn't in the fire. And after the fire, a gentle, quiet whisper. When Elijah heard the quiet voice, he muffled his face with his great cloak, went to the mouth of the cave, and stood there. A quiet voice asked, so Elijah, now tell me, what are you doing here? Elijah said it again. I've been working my heart out for you, God. Because the people have abandoned your covenant, destroyed your place of worship, murdered your prophets. I'm the only one left, and now they're trying to kill me. God. As if he didn't hear him the first time. God said, go back the way you came through the desert to Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael, make him king over Aram, then anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, make him king over Israel. Finally, anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel, Meholah, to succeed you as prophet. Anyone who escapes death by Hazael will be killed by Jehu. Anyone who escapes death, so he continues to give him an assignment. God does not even acknowledge Elijah's bemoaning. He doesn't even acknowledge it. But here's the deal. Elijah and him are such buddy buddies that he didn't just shut him out and be like, okay, I'm going to leave you in your place of bemoaning until you figure out that you need to come back and seek me. They're buddy buddies, so he's just like, Elijah, I get it. You're hated. Nobody likes you. Everybody wants to kill you. I guess I'll go eat worms. No, he doesn't even acknowledge him, and he gives him his next assignment. Now that season came to an end, and now I'm taking you into another season. There's no time for you, Elijah, to bemoan. I've got a lot for you to do. Now get back up and get busy. Here's your next assignment. Come on, look at God here. You think it's going to be different for you? We all try to reason God has an understanding. I lost my wife. I lost all my kids. I lost my cat and my dog. My house burned to the ground. So now I'm living under, you know, the charity down the street to help me. And I've paid my dues, so we're all good here. And I don't have to do another thing for the kingdom of God. When you did nothing, you fed soup to some homeless people maybe once when you were in college because you needed some credits. Like, come on. Bemoan if you need to, but hurry up because God's got more. Elijah went straight out and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, in the field where there were 12 pairs of yoked oxen at work plowing. Elisha was in charge of the 12th pair. Elijah went up to him and just threw his coat over him. Elijah deserted the oxen, ran after Elijah, and said, please, let me kiss my father and mother goodbye. Then I'll follow you. Go ahead, said Elijah, but mind you, don't forget what I've just done to you. So Elisha left. He took his yoke of oxen, butchered them. He made a fire with the plow and tackle, and then boiled the meat. Talk about consecration and commitment. That's your livelihood right there. And he just completely burned it all, complete forsaken. There was no of, you know what, maybe I'll put it in the stable in case things don't work out here so that I have it to come back to. He put everything on the line, completely abandoned it, made no provision for him to be able to turn back and come back. Come on, do you hear me now? Then he left, followed Elijah, and became his right-hand man. I love how the Lord, so you see, how the Lord just like, he cuts right to Elijah's heart. What are you doing here? This is a question the Holy Spirit is asking us when we get in fear and discouragement, or we're off course from seeking God's purposes. What are you doing here? What are you doing now? He loves you. I mean, it's like your little kid. You're constantly, everything they're doing, you're stoked out of your mind and rejoicing over them. But at the same time, there's sometimes I'm like, whoa, we're not doing that. We're not doing this crying business. There's not a reason for you to be crying, so we're not doing that. What are you doing now, Ezekiel? Right? And I love him. That's why I'm so a part of him, right? If God didn't care about us, he would have just left us and said, okay, do your thing. No, what are you doing now? You're not supposed to be in a place of fear. You're not supposed to be in a place of discouragement. Elijah, come on, buddy. We're always having fun together. What are you doing in this place? I'm not in that place. I'm not in discouragement and fear. Come on, step up. Be valiant, right? In all our lives, there are times when we get off course. We saw the brook drying up just to be a signal of a new season. Maybe today you find yourself dried up at a riverbed, but you've refused to move on. The Spirit of God says to you, what are you doing here? If there's not blessing all around you, what are you doing here? Our God is a God of blessing. He's a God of abundance. What are you doing here? There's so much work to be done in the kingdom of God. It's insane to not feel the press and the call of God. Let me say that again. There's so much work to be done in the kingdom of God. It's insane to not feel the call of God and the press of God. So many Christians, they're just burning their day saying, oh, I don't know what God's will is for my life. I don't know what my calling is for God. What is his will for my life? That statement is just nonsensical. Because when you get busy in the things of God, you're going to smack, slap right into destiny. It's nothing more than a distraction and an excuse. When you, I don't know what God has for me. I don't know what his call is for my life. Get busy. There is so much work to be done. You don't have to buy a plane ticket and go across the world. Step out of your back door. Get in your closet. Get praying. Get filled up with the Holy Ghost. Get praying for the ministers. Get praying for the leadership. Get praying for the church. Call in souls and step out your back doors and get activated. Open up your door for heaven's sakes. Feed people. Share the gospel with them. Whatever it is that's in your hand. Whatever it is. God will bless it when you give it to him. You consecrate it to him. Amen. As you get busy with as much as you can in the kingdom, keeping intimacy with the Father, relying on his strength for all things, you will step right into your destiny. You will collide right into everything God has planned for you. You know, you go to Jeremiah 1:5 and he talks about, I knew you in your mother's womb. I knew you before you were in your mother's womb. Every intricate detailed plan of your life, I was doing that. I don't want to get to heaven and say, oh man, God, I missed some of the details. I want to make sure that I fulfill every detail that God has planned for my life. There's no time for delay. Get busy. 1 John 2:20. And we have an anointing from the Holy One and we know everything. There's no excuse. When you've been baptized by the Holy Spirit, filled up with the Holy Spirit, you know everything because you are the Spirit. You have the Spirit of God in you. So many times we get under this lie of like, oh, I don't have enough word in me to be able to share. If you're in this church, it's crazy how much word you have in you. And even if you just knew John 3:16, you have enough word in you to go share the good news. Just stick with what you know. Amen. The more you set to know nothing of this world and the things of this world, and you set yourself fully and wholly on knowing what God knows, you become the wisest person alive. It's true. Kids that study the Bible and in school, They're usually the smartest kids in the class, unless we've got this crazy undisciplined thing that's been kind of going on in the church lately. But it used to be the kids that had the Bible were the smartest kids in the class. Because that God gives us the spirit of wisdom and knowledge when we're diligent with them, right? We're seeking the kingdom of God. Rejoice. Rejoice, the Lord has need of you. That's amazing. Rejoice, the Lord has need of you. Don't delay. There's so much to be done. Come on, in Jesus' name, let's get busy. Let's get busy in the things of God. God says, Elijah, what are you doing here? This isn't the place where we have fun together. This isn't the place of communion and fellowship. Why are you here? Why is your spirit in this place? The Father's not there. He's just like, thank you for reciting your circumstance. Noted. Now get busy. You must understand, it is time to stop camping out in your problems. It is time to stop camping out in your circumstance. It is time to stop camping out on dealing with yourself and your issues and your analytical brain, whatever it is, and just give it to God. Let Him sort you out and get climbing. Get climbing. Get hard at work. I use the word climbing because there's nothing easy about climbing. It doesn't matter how good of shape you are in, you will get exhausted from climbing. But if you're fat on this world and you're out of shape, it's going to be even harder for you and more exhausting for you. But nonetheless, get climbing. Start laboring for the master's business and your problems, I promise, will fade away. You can say, oh, my husband hates God. Or you can say, my children curse me and I got 10 kids and a cat that I have to feed and clothe and everybody's against me and so there's no place for me. That's a lie to distract you. Get climbing. Get busy in the things of God. To allow your problems to dominate your life is exalting your flesh above God. Let me say that again. To allow your problems to dominate your life is exalting your flesh above God. Who does that sound like? Satan. He exalted himself above God. Anything that's being exalted above God ain't good. So stop doing it. Hashtag no said, right? Come on. Come on, people, come on. Lord Jesus, everybody's tired tonight. We got all the new mommies in the house and all the new babies. It's so wonderful to see our house just multiplying and growing. It's beautiful. It's so beautiful. I love all you pregnant mommies and all you people with new kids. So taking a hold of the truth means no more prison. No more prison. But hold up. No more prison? That means no more being the victim. That means no more holding on to the hurts. No more holding on to the abuse and the pain of the past. That means no more being bound by sin. Some people don't want to get healed because now they won't have nothing to talk about. What are you talking about? How much that's coming out of your mouth is pain or hurt or offense or discouragement or fear or rebellion or doubts? We put a watch over our mouths. We start declaring the word of God. We start declaring faith with boldness, with thanksgiving, with rejoicing. Come on. It's time to be who God made you to be. It's time to be a worshiper of the Almighty. It's time to produce fruit no matter what season you're in. Yeah. No matter what season you're in, it's time to produce fruit. Because Jesus came to the fig tree and it didn't produce fruit and he cut it down. And he said, cursed, and you'll never produce fruit again. And too many times we say, this just isn't my season of producing. That fig tree, it was not its season of producing. We could say, Jesus, come on, have a little heart. It's not even its season to be producing. Give it a break. It's not its time. He said, cursed. Because he's telling you and I, we have no time for delay. There is never a season of your life where you shouldn't be producing fruit. You should always be having something before the Father. You should always be growing. You should always be living. You should always be actively engaging in the things of God. There is never a circumstance that is bigger than God. There is never a problem. There is never a hurt that should ever be bigger than God. But too many times we allow our flesh to be exalted above God Almighty. Too many times we come into the house of God with a frown on our face and we're just manifesting the spirit that we are of, saying, I'm exalting my problem, I'm exalting my flesh above who God is. So I'm coming before your throne with my bad attitude or my offense or my rebellion, whatever it is. They're all the ugly sisters. You walk into the throne room of God. No matter what you're going through, and you say, God, I give it all to you, and I'll worship you for who you are, not for who I am. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Get proclaiming the word over your life and over everyone in your life. The more you speak the word, the more you live in the word, the more you believe the word. Come on. Your own rebellion is what keeps you from comprehending what God has for you. It's time to go to war. It's time to awaken. Come on. Jesus. San Diego, man. San Diego, Lord Jesus. Let us have San Diego. You know, all of hell wants to stop you. And the question is, are you letting him win? And there's little tears that comes in. Little things. I'm too young. I'm too old. I'm not smart enough. I'm not pretty enough. People will actually believe these little things to allow doubt or fear to stop them from moving forward in the kingdom of God, from taking on the battle. This, that, there's no excuse that's good enough. If you've got just a couple scripture verses, you can even just carry the Bible with you and you got the whole word of God with you. Whatever page you land on is going to be something good that you can minister to somebody about. I mean, there's just no excuse. But too many times we're allowing Satan to win. When we delay, we're allowing him to win in our lives. These distractions, all of these different things. And you have to ask yourself, where am I allowing Satan to win? And that shouldn't sit good. That should make you fired up, angry, mad. I mean, to me, that's like a stupid example, but if there's a spider in my house, it must die. It does not belong in my house. I did not invite it. And then I scream and I cock it. Stupid, I know. Okay, but understand. Stupid example. But nonetheless, track. You should not allow anything in your house that's not been invited. And I don't think anybody in here has been actively inviting Satan. I know there was a period of time where we had some kids that were actively inviting Satan. They mostly all left. Sorry. We're praying and interceding. But some of them all, a whole tribe left. Anyways. you know, the Lord wants to do something tonight. And I'm not just up here to be telling you good stories. I'm not just up here to be reading my notes, which was downloaded from heaven this morning, to just have another sermon that makes people feel good. Or maybe doesn't make you feel good, but you came and participated. And I don't know what it is right now, but there's such a hindrance, and I'm asking the Lord to break it right now. The Lord Jesus, He loves you. He loves you so much. Oh, the love of God, that He bore all of our sins and all of our iniquities so that we could be one with Him, no longer separated from Him. The intimate fellowship and communion to interact and engage with God every single day of our lives is so wonderful, you don't want to miss out. You don't want to miss out. You don't want to miss out on a moment of heaven. Heaven, days of heaven, right now in your life. It's not for another day. It's for today. God has so much for you right now. He loves you so much. There's nothing in this world that even comes close to the love of God. You can't find it anywhere else. Oh, Lord Jesus. You look at Elijah, he's a faithful man. He'd worked really hard. Most people can't even understand how hard Elijah worked. He labored in the things of God. When you've done everything you possibly can, you feel alone, you feel exhausted, and everyone hates you, God still has more for you. There's another assignment for you. There's many people here right now. There's another assignment for you. Your greatest days are ahead of you. I'm not just saying this to motivate you. I could care less about motivation. I'm speaking by the Spirit of God. There is greater days ahead for you. You have the choice. You have the choice to stay stuck where you're at, in what you're comfortable with, in what you're familiar with, in what makes sense to the logic of man. Or you have the opportunity to take an adventure with God, to go into uncharted seas, to go into what doesn't make sense, to go where it's unfamiliar, to go where there's no rational logic to it. I tell you, there's greater days ahead. Jesus. Do not look back to the victories of yesterday. Many of you have had valiant victories in this place. But how many years ago? 5, 10, 15 years ago? 20 years ago? Do not look back to the victories of yesterday. The past is the past. What matters is your daily encounters and pressing onward and forward and valiantly in the things of God. This is your time, church. This is your time to live valiantly, executing the things of God. No more living in the victories of yesterday. You are not too old. You are not too young. You have not done enough. It's time to get busy in the things of God because God has greater days ahead for you. Anticipate what the Lord has for you in the next days and the years to come. Get a move on. Understand the Lord has you in a season, and you can choose to stay stuck or press on with the good fight, paying attention to God's assignment for your life. Imagine if Elijah would have called it retirement at the brook. We would have never had the continued stories that we had. God would have had to raise it up somewhere else, and we don't know how many generations later it would have had to take place. But Elijah was so seized by his best friend, God. Are you seized by your best friend, God? Do you know who your daddy is? Do you have an intimate fellowship with him to know he's your daddy and he will not hold one good thing from you? And when you're busy about the kingdom, he fulfills all of his promises. Thank you, Jesus. Understand, the victories of yesterday are nothing more than stepping stones. They're nothing more than stepping stones of a good soldier. It's our duty to win. It's our duty to be victorious. It's our duty to be valiant in the things of God and in the kingdom of God. You know, there's people, they want to give their children rewards for just doing what's right. And I think that's nonsense. You can have your own opinion, but that's just mine. Because I believe it is our duty to do what's right. Not looking for a reward for just serving God. For just being righteous and doing righteousness. That is our duty and our calling as a servant of the Most High God. Learning to be a valiant soldier. It is our duty to take ground in the things of God. It is our duty to win and be victorious over the plots of Satan, over circumstances, over problems. It is our duty to win. It is our duty to rejoice and be glad in all that God is doing. Come on. The race will soon be over. Very quickly it will be over. It's a blink of an eye and you're 50. It's a blink of an eye and you're 80. It's a blink of an eye and, I don't know, you're dead. So your eyes don't blink anymore. But you ask anybody. You know, you ask an 80-year-old, it was just yesterday that I was invincible. That is why you have to be measuring your life. I tell the youth, you better get measuring now. You better get running hard and activated in the things of God now. Because if you delay one more day, you're going to be 50 and you're going to say, what happened? Because we all know you get swept away in the hormones and the peer pressures of high school. And you're too caught up with just trying to grow up. And then you get to college and you're too busy trying to figure out what on earth are you going to do? What is my career? What is my place in life? And then you get married and you have kids and blinked, you're 50. Because we all know when you have kids, you don't sleep. So all the days just run into a blur. It's so easy for your life to just be but a vapor. We must be valiant in executing God's plan for our lives. Every day, being a good soldier, fighting the good fight of faith. You know, I used to be a track athlete. And you train every single day from the time you get up in the morning, everything you drink, everything you eat. It's all in a regimen, so to speak, for practice. Because if you don't eat well enough and you don't drink well enough, then your practice goes down. So any athletes in here, you kind of understand what I'm saying. And with your teammates, especially when you have a relay, like a 4x4, 4x800, which is what I did, with your teammates, you sleep together, you eat together, you do everything as much as possible together so that you're in synchronization. And you train for hours and hours and days. 24/7 is really about training. Everything you do in your life. I mean, my coach, he saw me wearing high heels and he ripped them off my feet and he's like, you're not wearing these for the rest of the season because it affects you. Like, everything you do affects your race and your training ability. And all of those hours, all of those weeks, all of those months of everything centered around your training for a race. And depending on the race, it's all over in under 12 seconds, or it's all over under 25 seconds, or it's all over under 60 seconds, or it's all over in 2 minutes. Depending on which race, 100, 200, 400, 800 meters. All over, that quick. That's our life. If we're not every day preparing valiantly, we've got one shot, people, this one life. One life, 70 years is not very long. It's not very long. We don't have time to be sitting around singing Kumbaya and saying, you know, whatever your will, O Lord, que sera, sera. No. His will's right here. It's laid out black and white, clear, plain as day. Go into all the earth, preaching the gospel. Bind up the brokenhearted. Cast out devils. I mean, come on. And if you're not doing that, then what are you doing that's participating in the things of God? You can have your interpretation. You can have your opinions. You can have all of that all day you want. But when you get to the throne of heaven, it's all evaluated right here. And I hope that made sense. Right here. Your belief system, your theology teacher, is not evaluated off that. It's not evaluated off your opinions. It's evaluated right here. And there is nothing mystical about the Word of God. A lovable pastor, he says, you know, who was the mother of Jesus? Mary. The Word of God is just that plain and simple. And all the other stuff that people want to get lost in the sauce about, sure, that's great to go and analyze, so long as you're crazy busy about the things of God, doing what he clearly laid out, simple for a child to understand. Thank you, Jesus. You understand that all of heaven is cheering you on. Even when you're doing nothing, all of heaven is cheering on. Martha, Martha, get up, get going. Yeah, 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 yeah. I don't know, that's probably not exactly what they're saying, but it's probably much better and cooler. But all of heaven is cheering you on. All of heaven's cheering you on because your name's written in the book of life. But it doesn't end there. They're not stoked just because of that. They're stoked about that. But they're cheering you on every single day saying, come on, there's more for your life. It's amazing. Get going. You can walk every day with little Ezekiel. I'm like, come on, stand up, stand up. You got this. I'm cheering. He can't do it yet, but I'm still cheering him on. Because one day he is going to take steps and start walking. I know that for a fact. There's no doubt in my mind. He's a very healthy, beautiful, normal child. And the Spirit of God, the angels, they're doing the same thing with you. They're saying you are a very healthy, normal child. The normal thing to do is to get up and get moving and get going in the things of God. So they're all cheering you on, saying, come on, come on, it's your time. Let's do this. Get going. Come on. And for years, they're cheering you on, not giving up. They're not going to give up till the day you die. You have all of heaven backing you up. You have all of heaven cheering you on, saying, I love you. You're amazing. You're doing it. Come on. Look what's ahead for you. Come on, people. Know how much your daddy loves you. But are you intimate enough with him to know that he's your daddy? Some people, oh, Father. You know, and it's like some mystical being in a far, far planet somewhere away. I tell you, you need an encounter with God. You need an encounter with the intimate Father, because he loves you so much, he wants to be right up in your face kissing you. It's amazing. I'm closing. I'm done. I'm just really just pushing this because I'm pressing for something tonight. I want some of you older people to start understanding that there is better days ahead for you that you haven't even gotten started hardly. I mean, you guys have participated in incredible things in advancing the kingdom of God here in San Diego. But my God, there's so much more. There's so much more. There's so much more. The music team, you guys can come up if anyone's available, but we don't need music. We'll take it. I'm just pressing for something here. I'm looking for something here. I'm looking for a miracle tonight. I'm looking for divine assignments to be imparted in you tonight. You know, I'll just share my heart a little bit right now. So these last few months, I've kind of been allowing other people to participate and stepping up in leadership with youth and, you know, giving them an opportunity to kind of learn leadership and learning some of the responsibility and the weight of it and just seeing what God does. And the Lord's just been blessing it and it's been awesome. But I've been in this press because I felt so strongly like there's something new the Lord has for us in youth, that we're going into another season. We're going into a new season. I've been just wrestling with it, and I've been, you know, to a degree struggling with it because I'm just like, God, it's got to be brand new. It's got to be something new. It's got to be something that's never been done before, because I've been just feeling the weight of something so big that God wants to do in this church in my heart. So for the youth, especially high schools. And just a few weeks ago, then pastor came and sat down with us and he's just like, let's restructure. And I was just like, yes, how do we do it? You know, and we haven't really had all the answers yet. And so, you know, I texted Jacqueline the other day and I said, I need the Smith girls praying. And I've had all the leaders of youth praying over this thing because I'm saying, God, we need divine insight and wisdom. Because what we had yesterday, it's been incredible. I mean, some of you guys know who you are. Where you were at, you know, the decision road of your life. Where you are starting to fantasize the thing in this world. You're starting to get caught up in the things of this world. The world was trying to influence you more in your life to take you out onto a different course. But yet God came and intervened for you, and you've set yourself to live for God. Sure, there's still things you're going. Sure, there's still things that the Lord's dealing with. But God's got every single person that's made it through the fires that we've had over these last months in youth. And it's been absolutely radical to see, and such a privilege and honor for me to get to participate in, to know, to be able to see Caleb White and know God's got a hold of him and he's going to live so valiantly for the things of God. To know God's got a hold of Caleb Scott, he's going to live so valiantly for the things of God. To know when I'm getting in my prayer time and I'm saying, God, who's on my team? And I know those boys, they're on my team. And the Smith girls, these girls, how they just so radically flourished and blossomed. And each one of you that stayed strong with youth, you stayed committed to it, saying, God, I'm so hungry for you. I'm sick of the things of this world. And it's been such an honor and privilege to get to be a part of seeing that happen in your lives. And it's been with great intercession over your children. It's been continual putting them before the Father, saying, oh God, you know what they're dealing with. And I break the chains and I break the influence because I intercede for your kids like they're my own. And it's been a good season. We've seen amazing things happen in these kids' lives. I mean, Frankie's a totally different person. You see, she's so lit up. And Annika is just so captivated with the things of God. I mean, all these different ones, where beforehand we just weren't sure. I said, oh no, any day now, will we still have them? Because I've been through this. I've walked through this. Most of my generation isn't in this church anymore. Because we have a fire in this church that says, you either live for God or you're going to go out into the world because you can't handle being in the fire. We love everybody. But you can only stay around the anointing for so long before you get driven out if you're not sold out. And so here we've gone through this amazing season in God with the youth, and it was all just focused on discipling and maturing and mentoring and dealing with what's in front of them right now. Look at, I tell you, when I was some of these kids' age, I was dealing with all hell against me. And I had lots of problems and issues. But what made the difference was I had a fear of God. And I never left. And each one of these kids that have made it this far, I tell you, they're here for keeps. There may be issues. There may still be learning. But you take a hold of it in prayer. In your prayer closet. And you let the Holy Spirit work it out in their life. And I promise you, He'll take care of them. I promise you, He'll fix every one of the problems. He'll fix every one of the issues. You just give it to the Holy Spirit and He'll do a far better job than you could ever do. I remember so many times coming in late at night and hearing my mom and dad in the room praying. And I knew they were praying for me. Do your kids know that you're praying for them? Because God will keep them when you put them before Him. Just give it over to Him. When my husband and I got married, the moment we walked into our room, we knelt down by the bed. We consecrated everything in our marriage and everything that comes out of the marriage to be to God. Before we took one step further to knowing each other, we gave it all to God. When Ezekiel came into our lives, we consecrated him to God, knowing that if we put him before the Father, God will do a far better job than we could ever do. You have to understand, parents. God will do a far better job than you could ever do. It is your job to take them in prayer before the King of Kings. To be the advocate, continually placing them, oh God. You see far more than I can see. You know what they're dealing with. We bind and break every attack of the enemy. And you prophesy over your kids in the prayer time. And it's been for a season of what we've been doing for youth, but now we're going into another season. And more than ever, parents, you need to be praying for your children. Because though we have them, the enemy is still going around like a lion, seeking who he can devour. And as we go into this new season, we are going to take hold of the high schools in Jesus' name. And the Lord is giving us wisdom on how to do it effectively. We're not going to do it like just anybody where you get pizza, you get a Bible study and you share your thoughts and feelings and interpretations about the Bible. Yeah, we can grow a big youth group doing that, but that's not what we're going to do. We're doing something that's going to be birthed right out of heaven. It's going to be so divine. It's going to be so mighty. It's going to so shake this city and farther than this city. And you have to be ready you have to be ready for the lost, because the lost has a lot of problems and a lot of issues. And you have to be the influencer, not the influencee. You have to be so built up in the faith and the intimacy with the Father that nothing can affect you, just love. Love being poured out for these kids. It's so strong in my heart about what's going to come in these next season. I can't shake it. It's every day I'm wrestling with this. Oh God, what is it? How are we going to do it? What does it look like, Father? Because he says, those who win souls are wise as a serpent, as gentle as a dove. It takes wisdom to win souls. And I'm looking for souls that get rooted and grounded, that go into all the nations of the earth. Because I tell you, people, the vision in this church is so big, we need more resources. I'm always looking to my left, looking to my right. Okay, Father, who's being developed in leadership now? Who's ready to start carrying some weight? But too many times we're delayed in our own things. The Spirit of the Lord is breathing. He's breathing over you tonight. He's breathing over this place tonight. Some of you, the Father is saying, what are you doing? What are you doing here? That was yesterday's provision. I've got something new. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. And you just worship the Father. And you just be who you are in God. God wants to do so much in each and every one of you. You're his favorite child, each one of you. You're his favorite child. And you're like, wait, I can't be, everybody can't be the favorite child. There's only one. No, man's logic can't comprehend. Every one of you is God's favorite child. He has so much for you. Don't stop. Don't allow yourself to be trying to just limit God and stopping short with God. Oh, I'm Paul with a thorn in my flesh. Oh, I'm just supposed to be going through this situation because it's God trying me. Everything that God has is good. Everything that God has is wonderful. Just a couple more minutes. We're going somewhere tonight. Just a couple more minutes on what the Holy Spirit wants to do in you tonight. I know it's a Wednesday night, but you wouldn't be here if you weren't hungry. So just a couple more minutes. The Holy Spirit is birthing a new thing within you. It is a time for a new season in your life. It is time for a transition. It is time to come out of the comfortable. It is time to come out of the familiar. It is time to come into the unfamiliar, into the uncomfortable. Some of you need to just do everything different. The way you wash your hair, do it different. The way the side you get out of bed, go on the other side. Just everything to just say, God, I'm looking. I'm looking. I'm seeking you. Because there's something new. There's something new that you have for me. This is a new season that I'm stepping into. I'll no longer be delayed. Thank you, Jesus. Family, I ask you, go to another place of prayer as we're in this season. Another place of intercession before God. We are about to do great things in this church. I can feel it. We're so close. We're on the verge. We're on the verge of the harvest. Be asking God, Father, where is my place? And as you're asking him, where is your place? Get so busy in the things of God that you're so exhausted. Because you'll lay on your pillow at night saying, this is fun. This is what my life is meant to be. This is the purpose that I'm to live for. Running so hard in the things of God. Come out of the comfortable. Some of you may be saying, what are you talking about, Pastor? I'm not comfortable. I'm as poor as dirt. Unless you obeyed Pastor Elizabeth and you don't declare. You don't declare curses over your life. I'm not comfortable. I'm just trying to rejoice and be thankful. We're so uncomfortable, it's crazy. I ask you, are you stuck? Are you in a false discomfort? A discomfort that's just keeping you distracted and bound. Because God has so much blessing for you. And if you're not willing to intercede for the breakthrough, to fight the fight, to break open the blessing, then I encourage you, maybe go have a meeting with Pastor of where to send you, because it'd be better to be poor on the mission field being busy about the Master's business than being poor here in San Diego not doing anything. Not anything of any significance. Because I tell you, God's a God of blessing. He's a God of abundance. I don't know, that was for somebody, I'm sure. Maybe on the web, maybe here. I'm gonna go ahead and close. It's kind of like the plane. Pretending to land, but then we gotta do another circle. We think it's our turn, but oh, you gotta do another circle. We're waiting to land here. This is big stuff. I understand why this is hard for some of you to hear. Kind of. I'm just saying I understand. I don't really understand. I'm just saying it. God's promises are good. In the stillness, in the quiet, I'll seek your face. And I know I'll hear your voice. You've given us this land for our inheritance. We take possession over it. We call every soul in this city into the kingdom of God. We wash every person in your blood. We bring every person before you now. Every person in this place we bring before you now. Let your blood come and flood this land. Let your blood come and flood this city. Let your blood come and flow like rivers and wash clean. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Come mold me, come break me, come shape me, come bend me, come break me. Conform me to your word. Conform me to your will. Oh God, you're all I want. You're all I need. You're all I desire. When I go through seasons where everything feels really good, I'll make sure to hit my knees and say, God, I'm more desperate for you than ever. I'm more in need for you than ever. Because when all is good, it's the most important time for you to make sure you're seeking God's face. Because when you seek God's face in intimacy when all is well, when it looks like disaster's all around, you won't even notice a thing. Because nothing about your relationship with God's changed. It's a place of intimacy. It's a secret place where when your knees drop, you feel all of heaven open to you. I'm talking to the people of God tonight. When your knees drop, do you feel all of heaven's open to you? I'm not saying to condemn you, I'm saying to call you. I'm calling you to a place of intimacy with the Father. Oh God, you're all I want. You're all I desire. Does your spirit burn within you for the things of God? The prophets of old said, it's a fire shut up in my bones. This is another realm. This is another dimension. It has nothing to do with the world. Purify yourself. Because I tell you, these encounters with God are for you. Every day, the pure in heart will see God. I've never seen him physically, but I know he's been all around me. He's been all inside me. And I know there's times when I hit my knees, and he's right there listening. And that's not just for me, it's for every single one of you. You find it in worship.
nothing to do with the head. It has nothing to do with logic or reason. It has nothing to do with analyzing. It's a place of complete abandonment. I know nothing, God. Nothing of myself. I'm determined to only know you. I'm determined to only know you, Jesus. Ministry is just an overflow. Miracles is just the overflow of your love for Jesus. It's not the focus. Words of knowledge, words of prophecy, it's just the overflow of worship and your love for Jesus. All of the gifts that he has for you, it's just the overflow of intimacy with the Father. Going into the world to preach the gospel has nothing to do with you, but everything to do with the intimacy of the Father, of worshiping the Father. It compels you, it seizes you. Money makes no difference. Laundry makes no difference. Plates and relics make no difference. When it's of God, it will be done. The colt will be loosed. Oh, we thank you, Jesus, for your convicting power that's here tonight, that compels every heart to come to know you in a more intimate way, oh God. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I need. You're all I desire. World will grow strangely dim. The more you seek the Father, the desires that you had before, they won't be there. The desires of the world, the things you thought you wanted, the things you thought that you needed and you couldn't go without, they won't be there as you seek the Father. The only desires that will be there, the only thing that will be left is holy desires. Desires for the kingdom of God. There's such a convicting power here tonight. There's such a sweet anointing here tonight. And I'm so thankful for every single one of you that's responding. Oh, Jesus. The Holy Spirit's knocking and he says, will you let me in? Will you let me in? Will you let me fill you with all joy? Will you let me fill you with all peace? Will you let me fill you with all righteousness, with all holiness? Let me baptize you in fire. A fire that cannot be quenched. A fire that the world cannot take away. Knocking and knocking and knocking, he's knocking. Let me in. I love you. Stop resisting me. I only want good for you. The world has nothing for you. Open up, before it's too late. Open up the door of your heart. You may not have enough.
darkness. I'm calling you out of your insecurity. I'm calling you out of your place of unrest. And I'm banging on your door to let me fill you with peace, with rest, with joy. An unquenchable rest, an unquenchable peace, an unquenchable joy. Open. Open. Holy Spirit, he says, it's not me who condemns you. The world has already been condemned. The fate of the world is sealed. I've come to rescue you. I've come to save you. I've come to heal you. But your choice is to let me in or not. Will you open the door tonight? There's anyone here tonight, you feel like you've held things back from God. And I know we could all respond to this altar call, but let me be more plainly clear. If you feel like you've been holding back your best from God, like you've been holding back the things you know very clearly, like, I've been holding back my heart from serving God. I've been holding back from opening up to the Holy Spirit to come in. Out of uncertainty or not sure. Or just hindrances that have come against you. We want to pray for you. That will no longer be in your life. That you'll just say, finally, I surrender. Finally, God, I'll surrender it all. He's knocking. Your life or mine. And I tell you, his life is so much better. I tell you, his life is so much better. His life is so much more. Knocking. He's knocking. He's knocking. He's knocking. An encounter with God. An encounter. Tonight is your night of encounter with God. Tonight is your opportunity to meet the Master. An encounter with God. Don't miss your encounter. Don't miss your encounter. There's new assignments being handed out tonight. Some of you are stepping into a new season. Oh, the presence of God is so here. The presence of God is so here. Every one of you up here, you just set your eyes on Jesus. In everything you do, you set your eyes on Jesus. Some of you that have had pains of the past, you've been through abuses, you've been through different circumstances, maybe sins of choices that you made that were just bad decisions. They come and they affect you. You lose sleep over it sometimes. Sometimes you feel like you can't even function properly because you're so seized by the bad choices or the pains or the abuses or the situations or the circumstances. You know there's deliverance, but you have to actively participate in that deliverance. One key that I've learned is whenever that happens, whenever that starts messing with my mind or starts trying to come into my thoughts and take hold of me, I immediately turn to the cross. And I start reciting all that Jesus did at the cross for me. All that Jesus went through for me. All that he carried for me. And how he went down into hell. And came back 3 days later victorious for me. And I tell you, the more that you do that, it won't be long that as soon as you say, "No, I'm thinking of Jesus on the cross," the moment that you turn your eyes to Jesus instead of what's going on in your mind, you will break. The power of that demonic thing will be so broken of your life, and all you'll be able to feel is the rejoicing, loving power of the Almighty God and how much he loves you, how much he rejoices over you. It is only Satan who tries to remind you. It's only an influence of his power. Not that you're possessed. It's just a lying thing that's trying to oppress you from having the rejoicing things of God, the good things of God. Do not be oppressed any longer. See Jesus, see Jesus, see the cross, see his love. See his blood. He has made you valiant. Will you let him make, will you let him be who you are to be in him? Will you let him be who he's supposed to be in your life? I'm a little drunk. It's not about my English words. It's about what's happening in the spirit. I could be up here saying rubbish because it has nothing to do with what I'm saying. It has everything to do with what the Holy Spirit is doing right now in the spiritual, in the unseen realm. Jason, you're a victorious man who the Father so delights in. Says, come on, take your place. Take your place among the mighty because you've been found valiant. There's nothing I'll hold back from you. Just only see me. Only see Jesus. Only see Jesus. Only see the provision. Only see the answer. Only see the faith. Trish, God's been with you in everything you've been through. Jesus has been standing there through everything that you have encountered and dealt with. Every pain, every hurt, every abuse, Jesus has been standing there right next to you, saying, turn to me. I'm here. I love you. I'll hold you. I've got you. I've got you, Trish. I've got you. Just turn to me, because I can't dwell with you in a place of discouragement and fear. I can't dwell with you in a place of sadness and sorrow. But I'm standing right next to you. Just turn to me and I'll hold you. Some of you up here, it's just little things that you need to start obeying. Some of the things that just doesn't make sense to you, you maybe you think it's just an opinion or just a preference. But I tell you, whatever's coming out of the man of God's mouth, just do it. Obey every detail and you'll be blessed. Say, Lord. You don't have to say it right now. I'm just saying for some of you that this applies to you. You can say it to yourself, you know, or later on. But just hear me. Say, Lord, open my eyes and open my ears so that I hear every detail of where I'm to obey. Because sometimes it's the smallest. Not sometimes, but always. It's the smallest acts of obedience. It's the smallest acts of obedience that break forth the blessings of God. And there's little things where some people that you've allowed rebellion to a degree because you've just viewed it as being a preference or an opinion. Tonight that ends. The provision will be there, because the blessing will be there. When it's under the covering of the church, the provision will be there and the blessing will be there. Some of you up here, you just need to get moving. Your heart's sensitive. Your heart's faithful to God. You just need to get moving. You need to get very disciplined in the things of God. You just dwell on the Word. And you dwell in the spirit of prayer, and you get busy. You say, no more laziness in my life, no more slothfulness, no more delay. This is for every person in the house. Holy Spirit's dealing with each and every one of you right now, especially you up here that have made the statement to come up. There's something that happens when you get up out of your seat and you come up to the front. The Lord can do a work in your seat, but there's something special that happens when you make a declaration by standing up and coming before the altar of God. It has nothing to do with what I see. It has nothing to do with what the people see. Has everything to do with what God sees. Tonight is your night. We're going to pray for these people that are up here in the front. Every one of you that are still seated. You just join up and pray with us.
you have to go, just go quietly and reverently, because the Holy Spirit is moving right now. The course of destiny for people up here is changing tonight. There's encounters with God going on here tonight. The Holy Spirit is moving. The Holy Spirit is moving. I ask you just to go to your knees and worship to the Father. In reverence to the Almighty God. Because He is in this place, He is in this house. And we're so honored that He's here. That He would be among us. Doing a work. A work that He will complete. With all perfectness, with all beauty, with all wholeness. Tonight is a night of champions. Champions for the kingdom of God. Every single person in this place is not here by accident. You are here by divine appointment. And the Holy Spirit is saying, this is your opportunity. Will you let me reign over your life? Oh.
Trish in the place of rejoicing. Oh, you'll find Trish in the place of giving thanks. Oh, you'll find Trish.